Altec was the shining light of week one for Gravity.
This is potentially the best team he's ever been on in the LCS. It's a very real opportunity.
Gravity picked me up as a new AD, and for me it was very exciting for a new environment.
He's had a lot of individual accolades from fans talking about his potential, but now he has a chance to actually shine as a team.
Gravity gets all the way through. They're gonna get these last two guys. A triple kill for Altec in his first game on the team.
I feel like Gravity definitely has an uphill battle here against Cloud9.
Sneaky has been one of the top, if not the top, AD carry in North America. Altec definitely has a big challenge ahead of him, working with his new partner, Bunny Fufu.
I definitely have high hopes for me and Bunny, as well as for the team. We can definitely compete with the top teams.
Welcome to the 2015 North American League Championship Series. It's game day once again here in Los Angeles, and the crowd is fired up and ready for week two of our summer split. As you can see, lining up outside, supporting their favorite teams, getting pumped up, lots of energy. Phoenix and the rest of Team Liquid looking relaxed. They'll be trying to extend their undefeated record against our newer team, Enemy here in Ox. Definitely getting in some last-minute practice, as you see, yet to change into his team gear, but maybe that's a pregame ritual. And, of course, Cloud9 getting in a little early today into the studio, and Ball's in the back doing the heavy lifting there.
Of course.
We'll see if he can do some heavy lifting today in their matches. Hello, everyone. I'm James Dash Patterson, and joining me for our first three games of the day are Aiden Zyrene Moon and Joshua Jatt Leesman. How are you gentlemen doing today?
I'm doing great.
Ready for some games?
Yeah, I'm ready for some games. I think all five matchups today are actually fairly compelling for one reason or another. Like the COG teammate game, Yen against COG. You go through every game and there's a cool storyline somewhere in there.
Well, and here's the thing. We're only 10 games into the summer split, and there's still a fair number of teams that are trying to, you know, suss each other out. So which are the teams that you guys are specifically looking at today?
I'm looking at Enemy Esports because whenever I ask people for their power rankings, Enemy Esports has always had the most variance in where people think they stand at the moment. And I feel like they haven't shown us everything that they're capable of, and especially in that game against TSM last week, where they gave TSM a big run for their money. Afterwards, TSM had nothing but praise and a very little bit of criticism. They said their individual skill was great and that their team play was the only thing that was really lacking, that they were losing objectives off of that. Back in Challenger, though, Enemy Esports was the teamwork team. And so coming into a week against the two-time defending champion with no practice for the last 2 weeks and fresh out of Challenger, that's a great spot to be in as Enemy. So I want to see them going forward today against the third-place finishing team, and that's going to give us a better idea of where this team stands.
Yeah, and I mean, I want to talk about the undefeated team so far in the LCS. So Team Liquid is going to be a really cool match right off the bat against Enemy because Team Liquid's a team that played well last week, but They played well by the fact that they got the victories, but they were not happy with their performance, and they played pretty easy opponents overall. And then we don't necessarily know the power level of Enemy, so how's that going to work out? And then COG, I'm just interested in that because Golden Age returns, right? How long will they be undefeated? They looked way better than any other team throughout all of last week, and it doesn't look like that collapse they had at the end of the split in the playoffs carried through to the start of this one, and maybe the roster changes are actually really positive.
All right, well, pulling up the standings, we see CLG and Team Liquid sharing the top spot, as Jat just mentioned. Then, of course, we've got the bulk of the NALCS tied for third place, each with one win and one loss. Finally, Team 8 and Team Dragon Knights are tied for ninth with two losses. Looking at today's schedule, though, up first, we've got Enemy Esports facing off against Team Liquid. Then Cloud9 will take on Gravity. And in our third match, it's a rematch of our spring playoff semifinals with TSM versus Team Impulse. Looking ahead to tomorrow, though, and our game of the week, we've got the latest chapter in the longest-standing rivalry in League of Legends, CounterLogic Gaming versus Team Solo Mid. And we've got lots of good matchups in store this week. We've hit on some of the teams that we'll be watching, but who are some of the players that you guys will be keeping your eye on individually?
Well, since I'm watching Enemy Esports, I think the big part of that team I need to watch this week is Trashy. Because their jungler, he was the guy who was out for those previous weeks, getting his visa taken care of. He was suffering from a lack of sleep and a lack of practice. This guy was a huge force in Challenger, both in EU and NA when he played in both Challenger series, and he was feared in the jungle. He was very aggressive early. He was making these teamfight initiations. And last week, he busted out an Evelynn. And when I talked to Enemy, that was their first game playing with an Evelynn jungle. And they whipped it out against TSM. And you can see right there, the gold was even 25 minutes into the game. And they come away with some great teamfights in that game, too. So I want to see Trashy step up to the plate and be the Trashy that we saw in Challenger.
Yeah, plus he's Danish, which gives him like 15 more league points.
That's like a plus five bonus to playing league. Yeah.
That's going to be exciting. I want to pay attention more to Kwas this week, because last week, specifically the two champions he played, Gnar and Rumble, he had big games on both of them. Gnar, ultimate after ultimate, he was kind of the consistent player to a somewhat inconsistent in-game Team Liquid team. So Gnar, he absolutely crushed. He got tons of big Gnar plays. I think that'll be a pick for him the entire split. And Rumble, he didn't do that great in lane. Calitrol started getting going on Aurelia, but then he had some spectacular Rumble ultimates later on in the game. And we always talk about, every time we give Kwas praise, the next week he'll go in lane egg. So we gave him praise. Maybe he can stay consistent, and that's what Team Liquid needs to be.
Our first MVP of the split. We'll see if he can continue rolling through with those MVP-like performances.
Yeah, and I want to talk about another guy too, Azingi, because this guy is a guy who's never really had an MVP performance. Last week, he had the best performance of his LCS career to date. He brought early game pressure to the lane of Kiwi Kid and Core JJ, and he ganked that lane and shut down Sneaky Elimination and freed up the map, which is how Dignitas works best. When they're able to roam around the map and they open up Kiwi Kid for roams and they get this early advantage on Core JJ, it's just a huge snowball. So this is the playstyle I want to see from Dignitas more. I want to see Azingi have early pressure and free up their laners, because they're really good when the map is open.
Yeah, he played great. Another guy who played pretty well last week was Keen, but the main reason I want to pay attention to this guy is because he plays unconventional champions. Keen seems to get his edge on the opponent by just playing things that the other guy's not used to, which works to a point, because if he's not winning the straight up matchups with Cassiopeia and Azir, how many new champions can you really pull out? There's 125 champions in League of Legends, but when you start thinking about the number of champions that are played in mid versus that can actually go mid versus things that people haven't seen, that pool gets much smaller. So I wonder how many more tricks he has up his sleeve.
Bard mid?
That's not one of the tricks.
Okay, shut down just like that. Another player to watch, though, is Lemon Nation. The man with the plan, Old Money Beard himself, joins Xspecial as the only players in the North American LCS to rack up 1,000 assists for the regular season.
Yeah. Unfortunately, we missed this last week when it happened. It was his fifth assist in the game when he got this. And what's impressive here is over in the European LCS, Yellowstar just got his 1,000th assist. Lemon Nation never played in the spring split of 2013. So he's done this in 28 fewer games than the people above him on this list. So assist per game and the pace Lemon Nation is going at is very impressive.
Yeah, out of everybody on that list, he has the most average assist per game.
Yeah, I mean, looking at this list, you see all of these names that we've known from the beginning of the LCS. They're still on this list, but Lemon Nation shot right to the top. Meteos not terribly far behind another member of Cloud9, which did not partake in those early splits. Well, that's going to do it for us here. We've got lots of teams and lots of players to watch. Now we're going to throw it over to our casters to get us into the games.
Thank you very much, Dash. What's up, everybody? Got an awesome crowd here. I am David Freak Turley, and hiding out on the caster desk until the heat blows over is Sam Kobe Hartman.
The heat?
The heat.
All right, I'm never going back, Freak.
Never going back. No. You're safe here. I'll keep them all off you. We're ready to kick off our first game of the day. It's Enemy Esports versus Team Liquid. Now, Enemy Esports are coming off a very close game against defending champions Team Solo Mid. With a few more solid performances, maybe they distinguish themselves as a playoff contender.
Yeah, definitely. Inox, he performed really well in the mid lane. Of course, he did get a lot of help versus Bjergsen.
Sure.
You know, he got ganks from not only his jungler, but also flares roaming down from the top lane to get that first blood. He's got a really another tough matchup today with Phoenix, because Phoenix has really started emerging as a very strong point for Team Liquid, transitioning from just strong scrim play into LCS play. Though Phoenix was a little bit disappointed last week, of course, with that solo kill that he chased Bishu a little bit too close to the turret and paid for it.
Yeah, it was a pretty good outplay overall, though. The thing is, I do want to sort of stress how good Phoenix really is. Last week, I got to talk to Incarnation in client on Sunday, and I asked him for his, like, mid lane power rankings, essentially. And he's like, TSM's hardest to play against because they spend so much time there, but it's like one-on-one, Phoenix is the hardest player to play against in the NALCS. So Incarnation gives praise to Phoenix as the number one here. But of course, we've seen throughout both these lineups that
almost everyone on either of these teams can step up and carry the game themselves.
True. If we look across to the other side of the rift, we've got Otter. He showed up really well for them. Week one went 10-1-6 against Gravity on Vayne and established himself as a true bottom lane threat. Vayne, though, of course, that is Piglet's favorite champion. We'll see how he does against the world champion.
That could be a fun one to watch for, absolutely. Now, speaking of bottom laners, though, Xspecial isn't too worried about Otter or the rest of Team Enemy, but that doesn't mean that Team Liquid are taking this game for granted.
I'm not too surprised about Enemy's performance. I didn't expect them to beat Gravity, but I don't think they're a strong team. I mean, they had a lucky game, I'd say, and I still rate them as one of the bottom few teams, but just because I don't think they're strong doesn't mean that we can underestimate them or even think that they can't beat us. I mean, we lose early game a lot, especially in the past few games, and we need to fix that, and we need to beat them in laning and beat them in rotations and just map movement as well.
Lucky game.
I don't think they're a strong team. Actually, for those who missed it in the audience, everyone goes, whoa, when he said that line.
Ooh,
so everyone's all ready for this one. Either way, let's check out the starting lineups. On the blue side, Enemy Esports. Flares in the top lane, Trashy in the jungle, Inox in mid, Otter on AD carry, and Body Drop on support.
And on the red side, it's Team Liquid. Up top is Kwass in the jungle. I will dominate. Mid, Phoenix, AD carry, Piglet, and support, Xspecial.
So we're going to get ourselves into game one of the day, of the week as well for North America. All 10 players in the lobby are going to be ready to go in a little bit. And I really want to see how these teams now approach the game now that we're into week two.
Mm. Yeah, now that we're on to patch 5.10,
mm-hmm.
How will they approach the Ryze problem? Probably ban it every single game.
Or pick it if you can. Yeah, if you guys missed the European LCS, Ryze was a pretty much first pick-worthy top laner in most cases. And seem to be very strong. I actually looked and Flares has not played it on his main account, if this is going to be first pick worthy. I haven't seen Kwass play much of it either, so that is a question for me in terms of what is prioritized.
I'm pretty sure they've been playing it in scrims because, quite honestly, you don't even need that many games on him. He's not a very complicated champion. Once you get down your initial opening combo, then you pretty much just keep spamming any ability that comes up. And you're good to go. And chase them. Don't forget to get some moves in there.
You have to get move forward and pretend you're playing Sona. Got it. All right, we're good to go here. LeBlanc, Sejuani, and Alistar all banned away. First pick, Gragas, though. Gonna continue the trend of 100%, and Ryze is left open.
All right, so strong jungler, all-around jungler. Gives nothing away here for Enemy. Very, very versatile first pick. Being on blue side, they don't want to give away any of their solo lane matchups quite yet. Although they are guaranteed to get counterpicked in one of them.
Absolutely. Now, it is worth pointing out, this is the first game of three where Irelia was not banned against Enemy Esports. The Hecarim now gone away from him. The Rumble is something that Kwass is happy to play. Those are the two champions Flares has played so far, so we might see that champion come out.
Yep.
However, all the Team Liquid things they really care about, Phoenix is Cassiopeia, Phoenix is maybe Azir as well, those are right open.
Yeah. Definitely a lot left on the board. As far as jungle as well, even though they Enemy Esports banned one jungle champion and first picked one, there's plenty for I Will Dominate to go to. Been a big fan of Rek'Sai, big fan of Nunu as well, so he's completely fine. And there's the Ryze, though, they were talking about. And I don't know, I really thought it was going to get banned almost every single game. Let's see what Enemy have, because all the teams are very well aware of the state of Ryze right now. So if you let it get through, you have something to counter it. And that is, you know, hard CC, silences, you know, maybe we saw Cho'Gath a little bit. Yep. He still does have a weakness to that Irelia that you talked about. She can close on him early. You can, he's still squishy early. It's just that basically if you want a TLDR of why Ryze is so strong right now, his level 16 power was moved up to level 6.
Yep.
So
he just kind of permaroots.
On both his passive and his ultimate, pretty much the value of those from level 16 was moved all the way up to level 6. So he gets really strong a lot quicker, and he could pull off those machine gun moves a lot earlier. Irelia, though, especially if she does get some early jungle support, you gap close on him, he's still squishy early.
And Greg is one of those best early game junglers with some hard crowd control to really make sure that maybe Kwass has a hard time. I do want to actually preface that there's a chance we see Ryze mid, just because we haven't seen it yet. You know, Ryze used to be occasionally mid laner or top laner. Phoenix still has not picked his champion for sure.
Very true.
So this is what could almost be a blind pick Irelia.
If you're gonna, you know, pull out all the lane swapping, we've seen Irelia mid
That's true.
As well. So that could easily just match the lane swap.
Oh, unfortunately,
if Baker did it, I can do it.
That's true. We saw Nuke Duck do it and nearly win with that as well. So a lot of fun things available now in League of Legends. You could pull, I believe it's a two-sin and play a support Aurelia. So three lanes for Aurelia in this year in Freshman
all
play.
All right, all right. That one, though.
I mean, one of the most varied champions in League of Legends right now in competitive. Either way, Enemy Esports do have to pick their mid laner as well as their AD carry. They know they're facing up against Kalista Thresh. Team Liquid got a lot of champions they really want. And it's mid Varus here for Inox. No Kog'Maw, but how about the attack damage version?
So that's definitely going to be the top lane Aurelia then. Varus in the top lane would be a very, very scary, scary situation for him. Team Liquid, I already like what they've set up here with the two very, very strong threats. So enemy won't be able to just focus one. We'll have to see how the poke does work, though. I like, you know, Varus with Gragas as well as Corki. This is a very early spiking poke squad because Varus, he spikes so much earlier than Kog'Maw because it's a basic ability he relies on for his poke. You don't have to wait till level 16 to get that huge spike. Yeah. At level 9, he's got his maxed out arrow, and you're just trying to pile on items after that point.
Exactly. It's just a matter of getting your Brutalizer, Last Whisper, Manamune in there, and sometimes that just comes in a bit faster than level 11 Kog'Maw. Team Liquid make their last choice. Looks like the hover is on Azir after all. So just a very sort of normal team comp for Team Liquid. Big team fighting mid laner. Piglet gets to be in a playmaker. Especially gets to make plays as well. And Kwas set up to carry. Any one of these guys could take over the game for Team Liquid.
Definitely. And that's been sort of a story for them. When one of the lanes, either you know bottom or mid, starts lacking in one of the games, somebody picks up the mantle. You know, week one, it was Kwas and I Will Dominate comboing for a huge carry for Team Liquid. We'll see what they do this time around because Rek'Sai's got his choice of lanes to go to. Her choice of lanes.
It's true.
We talk about early game pressure junglers. Gragas and Rek'Sai here, two of the best.
Yep.
So it's all going to be about the early jungle pathing. And who could get their carry ahead? I would definitely place my bets on the Ryze Aurelia matchup just because that is the most volatile matchup on the map.
Absolutely agree. It's even a long lane, so you can run people down if they get even farther ahead. Looks like the crowd's getting ready for the game. We're getting ready as well. You get to see just how fearful these champions really are. The first time we get to see Ryze here in North America, the first time Flair has been allowed to play Aurelia, and a whole bunch of fun things coming out here. So, what are you thinking? This game is going to be a whole bunch of fun. I'm taking it.
Yes.
I don't know. I'm just like amped up. I don't get to cast the first game of the day very much. So I'm just like more energetic than normal. Either way, guys, the teams are heading onto the Rift. Head over to Twitter. Let us know who you think is going to win. Tweet hashtag enemy win. Or hashtag TL would do at LOL Esports. Speaking is hard.
Freaks all hopped up on Mountain Dew. I'm at you like a spider monkey.
I haven't drank soda in like 3 weeks, actually.
Oh, nice. I'm proud of you.
Thanks. Here we go, guys. Game one, day one, week two.
Let me drink some Red Bull. Get on your level, Free.
Nobody can get on my level. That's how it works.
All right, let's see. Yeah. So if you have more questions about Ryze, the mana crystal start is definitely a thing of the past. Scales has plenty of AP scaling on him now. Ooh.
Oh, Inox winning the trade against Phoenix early on.
No joke.
Flask eaten.
Setting the tone right off the bat. All right. So, yeah, this is another look for Inox. Yes, he did. He was a very early adopter of the AP Kog'Maw mid, so they've definitely been a fan of mid poke style champions for a while. I haven't seen him play Varus.
Oh, yeah.
But they're off to that. Was it 10 gold?
Yep.
Trinket Ward?
10 gold for Trashy. That's going to mean very little in the long run. But it feels great.
I'm really curious, actually, since they all rushed out and only got defensive wards up. No deep wards to see lane swaps here. So I'm curious if we will even see the matchup between Ryze and Aurelia. Because right now, Xspecial up on the top side. So it looks like they will opt for a lane swap and try and get Ryze to level six as quickly as possible. Just because, well, yes, you still have your passive you can rely on pre-level six to pull off, you know, the semi-automatic machine gun style of Ryze. Once you get your level six, that move speed boost to chase people down ensures that They cannot run away from you once you pop your passive.
Well, as you talk about Ryze leveling up, he has started the Wolf Camp himself. He ranked E at level 1 for the area of effect clear. So Klaus going to do some of that. Inox, meanwhile, trading with Phoenix. These guys already battling back and forth.
Nice skirting around the range of the Sand Soldiers here for Inox. Yeah, Ryze, you pretty much always start E. It's so strong early in lane. Some people even put 3 points into E, or 2 or 3 points, just for laning phase, and then transition over to W. But a lot of people also just maxing W straight up for the permanent incarceration once you get level 6.
But right now, Enemy Esports going to go ahead and jungle the right-hand side of the map. We just a little while ago saw Xpecial look for the blue buff on the left side. That didn't happen, though. Quas puts a defensive ward, teleports to his lane. Mm-hmm. He's going to start leeching experience. And as my voice clears, Enemy Esports will get 2 buffs, as will I Will Dominate in the near future.
Yeah, let's see if they decide to go for the risky dive here, because even if you have a ward, Enemy can still shove in and try and cut you off. Gragas could try and cut off the exit route for Quas. And Aurelia heading bottom. They have 4 people bottom side. If you mess this up, though, and you give a kill to Ryze early on, it's going to be really rough. They're going to try and take advantage of his low base stats, though.
Ward over the wall by
running for the hills.
Gets spotted, and Quas going to hide very far back. Trick it over the wall, will not spot anything. That ward certainly does. He's all aware of this.
Yeah, he's just waiting for reinforcements. By the time, you know, Dominate gets here, they'll actually be well-equipped to take the... Oh, a little bit too early.
Trying to take the fight before the rest of the team shows up. Flash, body slam comes in with a knockout
from
Dominate.
Hits.
With some turret shots as well, and Trashy goes down. First blood comes in, Quas battling Otter. A nice hook from the backside, body drop with the ignite on Quas, won't get the kill. Otter the second drop as well, and Dominate to run away. 2 kills, maybe make that 3 as Flares tries to dive with the turret, gets imprisoned up. 3-0 Team Liquid.
All right, so we said if this goes poorly, if you execute this poorly, then you're going to have a really rough game. You don't take that chance. Quas even gave them a warning shot. All right, Phoenix is going to be next in the line for the train, able to get out with the dash. But man, Quas even gave him a warning shot firing off the E to let him know, I have a ward here. I've seen you for the last 15 seconds. We probably have a plan for dealing with this dive. And enemies still go for it.
Trash is going to lose his Raptor buff. Special's going to zone him off his own ward.
Can he?
Oh, well, yeah. Hold on, though. Yeah, you're right. Special does have Flash, but a whole lot of damage coming through. He's trying to get away. Flashes the wall. Yeah, he's fine.
All right. Special not backing down from a fight over a ward. They're very important to support players.
Flash reward, I guess. That's worth it. I feel like it's not.
Just because they gained so much early game, it's not going to be too big of a deal. He did use up 3 people's time. We'll see if he ends up paying for that. Yeah, see, not only... All right, well, you pretty much know the story here. Basically, the biggest mistake is Trashy flashing into turret range. 1 turret shot, 2 turret shots. Dominate jumps on the opportunity, by the way.
3 shots.
Good job, yeah, 3 shots. Dominate jumps on the opportunity, so good job by him reacting to the bit of a misplay there. But man, the cleanup is brutal. Quas also... just sort of baiting in here, chugging his potion, and he has a shield. Flares, I guess he did not have E up for that all in, but definitely the move of a desperate man there.
All right, well, a great lead for Team Liquid. You know, it's, I think he'll live, maybe. Xpecial said that they were worried about the early game maybe a little bit, but that they expect to beat Enemy Esports. Well, with an early game like this, Team Liquid has to feel very confident they're going to take this game home.
Definitely. They have so much scaling. Ryze, Azir, Kalista all look pretty good for them. We'll see how they do the mid game, though. Definitely need to transition this early lead into some extra ward coverage so that Dominate... Oh, here comes Dominate. Speaking of the Rek'Sai herself.
Oh, almost in range of the Rune Prison. Flares turns around, gets hit up. One more spell! Oh, won't quite die, but Flares... won't quite die.
Passive not quite charged there for Quas. You can check, by the way, how close he is to popping his passive. Those the new icons around him, around his feet. You can see once he gets up to number 4, his next spell will trigger it. That's also why You see, like, Hunian guys earlier in the EU LCS just throwing out random Qs every once in a while to keep up their stacks.
Also of note, Quas has not gone towards tier just yet. Typically, the rises I see rush tier, the Goddess, get it stacking early on, but he's looking at like parts of Catalyst first.
True. Guess he was aware that enemy are not afraid to go for early dives, wants a little bit extra maximum health so that he can survive any shenanigans. I still think that he will, you know, turn the end attack, Catalyst, go Rod, go tier. But you're right, we'll be delayed a bit.
Let's see, as we go ourselves. That's true. Those are a lot of really good champions.
Owen is dumbfounded.
First pick Rag is definitely strong, but you're right. Right now, the dual lane of Team Liquid, despite being slightly down in items, as Piglet hasn't backed, doing a pretty good job of winning the 2-on-2 here.
Yeah, and this lane, Thresh, Kalista, it's so hard to punish this lane. Even if you wanted to try and focus Piglet in this game, bringing jungle pressure just seems so futile. As a jungler trying to gank a Thresh Kalista lane. All right, well, here goes the double hook-ins.
A lot of damage dealt back, but it looks like Otter wanted to get away off the back, so body drop nearly living up to his name. Low on health here. Dominic coming back with Quas, the movement speed, looking for flares. They're going to probably land the
passive.
Root. And the knockout, the passive is on. A whole ton of damage, and the tenacity that Aurelia gets, not going to be enough. Fourth kill for Team Liquid.
So, about that Ryze Aurelia matchup, yes, that's going to attract a lot of jungler attention.
Yep.
Finally does pay off here. Dominate sticking to the game plan, returning to bottom lane, as it were, one versus one, and they're able to take down flares again. What a start for Team Liquid. The only thing that they might be a little bit sad about is that Quas didn't get the last hits for any of these kills.
It's true.
So, he will be a little bit delayed, but very, very happy with the way the early game is going.
Even with mostly assists, he's still sitting on more gold than Phoenix and practically as much as Piglet here, so you can't be too bad or too sad if you're Quas right now. Even individually, he's up like 1,000 gold over flares. So this matchup, definitely feeling good for Team Liquid.
You know, as they say, things could always be worse. Things could always be better as well.
That's fair. That's fair. Team Liquid could be 18-0 right now. Now, wouldn't that be great?
All right. But honestly, this is going to be a arduous path back to even an even game for enemy. It could be very difficult for them to work their way back in this one.
All right, let's see how they do it. The game certainly isn't over. It's just one with an advantage right now. Trashy looking for a lane gank, has snuck through the brushes. But as soon as the wave pushes out, Quas just recalls back. He's very cautious about this. He's one of the top laners, has very good sense around when he might get ganked.
Yeah, you can also tell, you know, how strained enemy feel right now. Trashy going for that lane gank onto a lane that Ryze is double the CS of Aurelia. He's going back to purchase right now, so he's going to have a huge, huge advantage in that lane. If for any reason I Will Dominate is on the bottom side of the map or even has a tunnel there to teleport to, that gank gets turned around on you. You get destroyed in the two versus two. But he's got patience. He knows that they have to make this work or else Ryze is going to get out of control. So go all in for it.
Stays the entire time. Still has flash. Gets knocked back into the team. There's the 2-on-1. Quas gets the shield. He flashes backwards. And Flare starts running away. He turns on a Trashy instead.
So imagine if that was 2-on-2 Freak.
Oh yeah, they'd be dead. Like last time.
This is Ryze in the current state of the game. Pop his ultimate, gets the AoE off.
Flare's trying to go for time. He's 2 hits away from getting the kill. The body slam lands. There's the kill picked up, and Otter's joined to the fight. Summoner heal used to keep Trashy alive. The lantern pulls out. I Will Dominate.
Yeah, maybe that was a bit of hubris from Quas. He started up the re-engage or the bait before Dominate actually closed the distance. So that's a huge win for enemy. When we talk about the steps that they're going to need to take to get back in this game, that was definitely a welcome kill down bottom.
We'll see how many more steps it's going to take for enemy esports. Right now they sit down about 4,000 gold in this one. No global objectives gained. That's just farm and kills. In fact, every single lane winning in farm right now. Making sure the Team Liquid really are feeling great early on. Flares will lane swap to the top side to face Piglet. But that's nearly Bloodthirster versus just components worth 400 gold here. Flares can't feel good about this matchup. And you're seeing the kind of damage he's taking. Great hook by X Special. This could be a kill on a body drop. Top lane turret dies to Piglet in the meantime, but nothing picked up on that bot side. Body drop can feel safe.
Let's see how they swap this back, because if they actually leave the lane pushing... Oh, good. They've got it pushing towards Quas, so he can feel fairly safe on the rise. You really have to protect him now. You know, he does not have flash, and enemy have decided to start focusing him. Still sitting on mostly mana items, so there is a possibility of, you know, chain stunning him, 100% to zeroing him. But, you know, anytime the counterplay to a champion in the game is just stun lock them from 100% to zero.
Yeah, that's good luck with that one.
That's a strong champion. All right, body drop and special trading blows.
Play box, a lot of auto attacks. Body drop forced to flash out the box, but here comes Dominate. Flash knockups too. Body drop puts the ult down to only stun up really one. Still drops down 1-0 again. Team Liquid farther ahead.
All right, Dominate again. Another move down bottom. Still the ward coverage here.
Oh! Yeah.
What was that? We need a replay of health.
8 health?
Like, all right.
That's my guess.
You sounded so confident. I thought you saw it.
I saw regen to 11. So
definitely
kind of
single
guess. Yeah.
But the ward coverage here for enemy is obviously going to be lacking because they have zero map control. But they need to try and get some defensive ones up at least. Right now, they're just taking gambles of, you know, the move, going for risky moves in places they just hope that Dominate is not on the map. That's really, really hard against Rek'Sai because she, you know, has the global, can jump across to where she pleases. Dragon number one does go down.
Thresh is at 4 health, by the way. I got that one wrong. Thank you very much, guys in the back, for telling me the number. But yeah, so first Dragon comes through to Team Liquid. A lot of leads everywhere on the map. We don't watch the mid lane much, but Phoenix has been getting very far ahead of Inox. This Varus so far not doing a whole lot in the matchup. Just trying to farm what he can from range.
And if, you know, if we are talking about vision there, we can critique Team Liquid a little bit. They have such a substantial lead right now. They could very well, you know, shore up their vision very easily, especially around that mid lane you just talked about. You know, make sure that enemy don't have any windows back into the game. They're leaving it a little bit askew.
And we'll see. Maybe Team Liquid will make him install Mac OS instead. Get rid of the windows here. Here comes the engage, special looking for body drop. Oh, does not quite stop the anchor toss, but Fate's Call might help. Body drop knocked up. Gonna get locked down. Piglet to get the rend kill. There we go. 6-1 Team Liquid just everywhere on the map.
Yeah.
I Will Dominate is there, killing someone of enemy esports. And now Inox looks for the play.
Whoa.
Banana engage. There comes the flash knockback, and Ryze is here. The first kill that Dominate misses. Great plays by Phoenix and Quas.
Surprise. Quas is in town. Shoved up the top lane there. Move down mid. Take down the turret. All right. Time for Team Liquid to close the noose. Outer turrets first on the docket.
That one's down quite low, this bottom one as well. Otto's got nowhere to run to. Bit of a fish out of water, gets knocked down. Piglet takes him out. And that bottom out of turret sure to fall. Now Dominate finds Trashy. This man's also really in the wrong spot. Jumps over the wall, and he's gonna stay alive.
That was a stretch, Freak.
Yeah.
An otter is not very close to a fish.
It's a mammal.
Not very close at
all. Much like Otter the player, also a mammal.
All right, there's your connection. Great. but honestly, yeah, there, even with wards, there is nothing you could do against a Rek'Sai lantern gank over that wall. Really, really, really tough situation for all the entire team. All right, so Phoenix, a little bit off on the drift there to the side, but doesn't matter. He has all of his summoners available.
Oh.
Oh, wow.
Tried to flash jump away from Quas, yeah.
Can't even get over the wall there. Soldiers doubled up.
Yeah, that was the first time we saw those mid laners fight, and it wasn't a fair one. Good job, Team Liquid, though. The fact that everyone on the map is running around so well and making great making great calls, and again, they find botted up once more. TP comes in from Flares, the CC onto Xspecial, who can just get Fates called out. It's a bunch of wasted damage. Flares getting targeted, might get picked up. Piglet gets one. Now the re-engage from botted up. Aquas has joined in the fray, and it's going to be more kills coming through. They do knock down Rek'Sai, but a second kill for Piglet. Make that another one for Aquas. Xspecial trying to get away from Trashy. Does get the kill, so at least two picked up for enemy esports, but Piglet gets three. Aquas gets one. Even Phoenix grabs one for the cross-map ace.
As predicted, this is going to be one of the strongest stomps of North American LCS so far. Team Liquid, off of that early missed dive from NME.
Yeah.
Into probably the worst area on the map for them. Really, really difficult for them to come back from this. Not to mention, you know, Team Liquid was such great. Ooh. Can he how does he follow it up, Freak? Dash.
He presses his keys on his keyboard. W-E-Q.
He's just waiting for the cooldown for his Sand Soldier dash again. What's it called?
Arise, Shifting Sands, and then him. E is... I'm going to hover over it and figure it out.
You already said it, Shifting Sands.
Oh, it is. Oh, the other one was Conquering Sands. Oh, okay.
Makes sense.
Emperor's Divide's the ultimate. Didn't look that one up. I just knew it.
A for effort.
It's like my job is to read off Champion Piglet or something.
Piglet currently 6-0, by the way.
Yeah, he's doing great.
Stat line there.
He wasn't even part of those first three. He was chilling, farming top lane monsters.
Yeah, we were so focused on the bottom lane. Piglet here. Let's see if we can pull off a 1v2.
He walks into him.
I like it.
And they don't even fight back.
The odd job strafe.
Jeez. Oh, gosh. Now Piglet on the chase. He did get the rend reset, by the way. So body drop.
Take him on, Piglet. Keep going.
All right, wow, what a pansy. I would have fought that.
He's just waiting to even the odds here. Special's got his back. Time to 2v3.
I gotta say, even the odds is a cool term. Because they both refer to numbers.
That one was at least better than the fish out of water referring to an otter, which was ridiculous.
It's an aquatic animal, at least.
All right, turret go down is pretty quick. Summon a shoulder on top of it. Nice little chunk there. Blue buff on the Azir. Siege is easy. Skirmishing is easy. Pretty much everything is easy for Team Liquid at this point. And man, we talked about, you know, last split, Team Liquid, they had a 2-0 start. You know, this time they again had a 2-0 start. But people are questioning the strength of schedule for them. This again, enemy, one of the new teams that came into the league. However, this game has been, you know,
they're most convincing by far.
Definitely, the execution this game has been much better for Team Liquid. So,
man, speaking of execution, Binder Drop might get to walk about four paces before flashing the wall and still dying. 15-3, second dragon picked up, three turrets as well. Very few things are going well for enemy esports this game. And practically everything well for Team Liquid.
Yeah, Team Liquid definitely feeling good about themselves so far this split. Piglet already up to the Bloodthirster plus Runons as well, so.
That's early.
He can definitely go for poor odds as far as taking, you know, pretty much any fight the enemy decides to throw at him.
Alrighty, so 11,000 gold lead at 20 minutes, one of the biggest disparities we have seen in the NALCS and in competitive League of Legends as a whole. 20-minute Baron could be a thing. I mean, pretty much anything, as you said, right? All the objectives are easy. All the skirmishes are easy. Mm-hmm. The question is, what does Team Liquid do with this kind of a lead?
Exactly. Move up your vision, control neutral objectives very easily. I mean, they have the option of going for sieges with Phoenix, but they don't even need to give that opportunity for enemy to get a miracle Gragas ultimate that, you know, might knock one person under their turret. As long as they just control the map.
Well, they're going to control it through Baron. Scuttlecrab respawns. Ward gets put down. Specials in the brush, though. Hooks up Otter. Goodbye, AD carry. Flashes out. Does stay alive for now. Fate's call. Maybe to re-engage. Baron's been picked up already, so the rest of this fight is with bonus attack damage and ability power. There goes the kill on the Nautilus. Knock up once again onto Otter. Special quite low, but wow. Inox gets the kill. I will dominate. A one for one so far. Flash engage. There's the dodge. Flare's now getting locked up only on a Triforce and boots one. More poke coming down. The team trying to disengage. Team Liquid only get one kill. Oh, take that back. Piglet is legendary. Nice kill for him. Maybe a turret too.
All right, definitely a turret. Let's see if they decide to recall because their waves are not pushed up very far. So just going to take the safe route here. Everybody got chunked fairly low after that. Yeah, not ideal giving up the kill on Rek'Sai, but got Baron, got two for one. Pretty much as expected there for Team Liquid. Now that they do have Baron buff, their siege much easier to pull off. They could actually split very effectively as well, too.
Yeah.
You know, push several lanes at once with the Baroned up minions, just because they are so strong.
And with all the threat that Rek'Sai, Azir, Thresh can kind of project, even the Ryze route, the wave clear options get a little bit worse. Normally, Inox can charge a Q and knock down minions decently well, but yeah. With all the fall-off damage of Piercing Arrow, he can't even kill the caster minions very easily, let alone the fact that the melee minions just take 80% reduced damage from champions. So actually knocking the minions off the turrets is already a difficult effort for enemy esports.
Yeah, it has to be a combined effort from Trashy and Otter as well, lending what they can to try and take out the minions. Looks like the focus will be bottom. 1-3-1 initially from Team Liquid, but everybody making their way down to knock out all the outer turrets first, clean up all the global gold there for the squad.
Yeah.
Finish the game out cleanly, get more fantasy points.
All right. If you're running Team Liquid, it'll be a lot of points for these guys. Just put the wards down, make sure that Piglet's not getting flanked and the rest of the team joins when he does reach the turret. Now to the inhib turret, but you're seeing the risk aversion of TL. They don't get much damage on that structure just yet.
Yeah.
They're letting Quas push top him because he's uncontested here.
Yeah, nobody can 1v1 the Ryze at the moment, and even a 2v1 is a fairly scary situation.
You saw it before, they didn't even win. All right, one more attempt now, and you can see, again, playing pretty safely until they see Aurelia join the top lane.
All right, so all-in prospects from enemy. Trashy has to get an amazing Gragas ultimate to split the team and get alone time with one member of Team Liquid under the turret. Then maybe they could pull off a kill and try to hold. Barring that, Team Liquid, pretty standard here, trying to close the loop.
Well, Baron buff's timing out on this wave. This is the last chance they've got the buff, and actually it times out right now. Here comes Vitor up to the front line, hooked in. A lot of damage dealt. Special is low, but Fate's Call keeps him safe.
Phoenix low.
Ooh, low health on Phoenix indeed, but they can't get the kill. Quas stuck in the top lane, pushing things down. And slowly but surely, the turrets are losing more and more health. Team Liquid aren't losing any kills, and they can recall, heal up, and take Dragon 3 in a minute.
All right. Just going to back off. Got all the outer turrets that they were looking for. Increase the global gold lead there for Team Liquid. And the standard execution. Now, looking forward for this team, they've definitely shown that they can carry from all three lanes, especially by their champion picks this game. I mean, well, if you're going to get the option to pick up this strong of carry champions from all three lanes, of course they're going to take it. But definitely showing that all three of these lanes want to be the carry for the team. And we'll see if later on in the season, if that does start to cause any problems, you know, if there's a game where they have to actually fight over CS and they can't freely farm all three lanes and you get to that mid game where you only have a couple choices of, you know, one or two free lanes of farm, who do they decide to give it to? Because Phoenix as well definitely wants to be a point man for this team.
Yeah, absolutely. It's so funny seeing how little Phoenix has done for team fights. He's been stuck in the mid lane, just pushing minions down. He's been part of two of the 17 kills. Just like everyone else is winning. It's like my favorite solo queue game. I'm just farming, and my team's winning in every single other lane. Show up for team fights. The Dragon number 3 going to be easily picked up by I Will Dominate and Expecials. The rest of the team runs around the map. The red buff respawn. Maybe Piglet goes for that first. Seems like Teal having to take their time, grab everything off the map. They've seen games be very hectic before, and there's no bonus points for winning fast. They've indeed cleared their entire jungle away before moving on the other side of the map.
Yeah, in fact, there are bonus points for winning by collecting everything on the map and winning slower, I guess. If you're looking at fantasy.
One of those completionists.
Yeah.
They gotta grab like all the gold school chulas.
Conquer the world. Well, from NME's perspective though, they're probably still thinking about that level 2 play, the very opening minutes of the game where they decided to go for the dive even after Team Liquid basically alerted them that they knew what was going on.
We've seen that play, though, go well and badly. Sometimes they zone out the other three, and it looks so good.
So you can chalk it up to just that mechanical error of Trashy getting, you know, flashing, body slamming just a little bit too close to the turret, and then Dominate being there for the knockup to ensure he took three tower hits. Yeah. If they didn't take those three tower hits, then yes, it could be a completely different story. It definitely wouldn't have been
as bad,
an all kill for them. But probably going to have to revisit that one. And, you know, shore up at least the clarity of shot calling for this team.
Well, they've got another match tomorrow. We'll see if NME can fix those mistakes. Right now, though, Team Liquid just kind of... This is basically what sort of 5 versus 0 League of Legends would look like if you were to play the game, like, sort of strategically and, like, cut off all the escapes. NME Esports not really contesting with anything because they can't. I'm thinking at this stage
of the
game.
True.
Right? The last 15 minutes have been Team Liquid sort of, like, anyone aspiring to be a shot caller can go watch the VOD and, like, watch all the word placement and be like, this is what a team should do if you never get opposed. All these wards, all these rotations, this is what Team Liquid will do without opposition.
Just methodically cleaning the map of all resources.
Yeah. I mean, there's, like, what would be the in for NME Esports at this point? They can barely get farmed together. Both jungles being farmed by Team Liquid, all the neutral decks going to them. There's just no inroads.
Yeah, pretty much. Hotshot's got the right idea. It does get a little bit hard to watch when you have that big of a lead. You feel bad for the underdog at that point.
Man, Dom didn't even need Smite to last hit that Baron. Burrowed Q took it.
Grats?
He outlast hit Ryze, man. I'm just saying, this is how good Dom's mechanics are. I'm just saying at this point. Yeah. I'm making up fake storylines.
I like it. You are digging deep. Stretching.
Isn't it cool how Phoenix picked an Avian champion?
Let the crowd take that one. Are you going to compliment him on his arrow dodges now? He's dodged 2 in a row, freak. That's all you need for a line.
I don't.
2 points.
All right.
Let's continue on with the split push here. 4-1 here for Team Liquid.
Ooh, Dominate a bit close to the enemy champions, but he's so tanky he barely even cares. Doesn't even register the damage.
At what point do you decide to go for a tower dive here? Because Dominate's getting pretty tanky. He's got the full tank Rek'Sai going.
Yeah, I just feel like there's actually so much crowd control, like Verisult, Gragasult. You can totally screw that up. Like, no matter who's the one who gets isolated, you can knock Azir and Kalista back, and then Rek'Sai is alone. Like, she is going to die under an inhibitor turret. Now, I do think there's room for a bit more, like, Azir presses W once in a while to knock the turret down. I think these turrets could definitely die fast.
Hello, Ocker. Freak. You could buy an Ohm Wrecker.
You could buy an Ohm Wrecker. Oh, man. True. Gives cool. Health and armor. And
if you are this far ahead in gold, buy a Gnome Wrecker.
Oh, Phoenix!
You can do that.
That's like a Messiah status play. He burned like 3 ults on himself. I mean, he didn't use Flash, and now Verisult is down. So what are those good, like, counter gauge?
They show just how strong their team comp is right now. You can make a mistake like that and just, you know, zone and wait for a lantern to get out perfectly.
Wow.
Without having to blow summoners.
Dom almost got knocked into the turret. The explosive cask was used, but he stays alive. But you're seeing the defensive power of NME Esports. The fact that they're just playing slow and methodically and waiting for Teal to go into them, you're seeing Liquid actually have to respect that. But Dom recalls, ults back into the fight, and it's like nothing ever happened.
All right.
This might be the wave.
4 hits on that turret, let's say. If Azir is there.
Well, that wave had 0, and Phoenix is still running around the map, various sides, finds some damage into Flares, but gets poked back out by Inox.
Yeah, honestly, the enemy squad, you know, we talked about their mid-game poke from these guys. The quirky Varus plus Gragas is strong at defense here, and since they were so far behind, their mid-game basically is now.
Yeah, all the power spikes have come in for enemy esports,
because
guys.
They're so behind on gold.
They're down 19,000 gold.
All right,
here
there
comes
it is.
The engage. Couple of hits onto the turret. That will be it being picked up. 5v4 inside the base. Body drop gonna get locked up there. A stun on a Piglet, but is there enough damage? The AoE root from Varus not doing enough to keep the team alive. In hip will get killed. Some poke from enemy esports might not do nearly enough here. Flash in from Quas, finds Inox, takes him down onto Otter. That's the third kill of the fight. In they go to the base. I will dominate Crest 10 assists.
Leave
10
it at 420.
Kills for Piglet.
Ah, don't kill anybody.
Oh my gosh. Well, we'll see what the rest of enemy esports does in this one. Trashy's up at the front. There's the flare. There's a whole bunch of damage. 421. Phoenix will get his first death of the game. Flares gets on the scoreboard of the second kill.
Dominate.
That's going to be GG, though. 5-21, 5-22. Team Liquid, in a dominating fashion, take down enemy esports.
What is this?
Everyone's shoes.
Yeah, what?
Should I just, like, take mine off right now? Will that make me cool?
I'm down.
All right, here we go. I'm going to unlace.
I don't like wearing shoes.
Alright. I got boots on. Do you have like sneakers? Oh, you got boots too. Okay. Good to know. Either way though, enemy esports putting up a valiant effort, but Team Liquid 3-0 to start the split out, certainly. The kind of start you would want for your team, not losing, who would have thought?
All smiles there from Peter as well. And you have to say, Peter, good job in Champion Select.
Yeah.
Being able to come away with that squad.
Yeah, it was strange seeing some of the picks come through. I mean, the rush pick on Gragas with Rek'Sai still up, that always raises a couple of eyebrows.
Yeah.
They didn't try to ban out Phoenix. I think there are already a lot of good teamfight mid laners. The top four seem to be Azir, Cassio, Victor, Vladimir. Seem like the general top tier of like teamfight damage mids. So, well, just pick one of the four. We can't get rid of all of them. But I mean, Piglet allowed to hard carry Kalista if he wanted to. The Ryze came through. Again, we thought that was going to be a big deal. Ended up being a big deal. He crushed everybody.
Yeah. To be fair, that early dive, if they had, you know, performed it the same way, it would have turned out the same way on a different champion if Ryze was not in the game.
That's true. You're absolutely right about that. He managed to scale pretty well, but yeah, when you flip the dive, you take three turret shots on a level three jungler. You tend to give up double buffs, and the game goes badly from there. So enemy esports certainly have one big thing they can look at to shore up execution-wise. They, I think, played fairly smart in terms of rotation play. Once they were that far behind, they defended around turrets, didn't give up too many free kills around the map, but I do really like Team Liquid's killer instinct. They had forced so many ganks by lanterning Rek'Sai over the wall, tunneling in, knocking up Body Drop, killing him for like the seventh time in the game.
Yep.
That was good stuff by Team Liquid.
Yeah, Dominate had some very impressive ganks to snowball this game.
Yeah.
And keep, like you said, it wasn't until, you know, like 20 minutes in until someone got a kill without Dominate being there.
Yeah, it was like the seventh or eighth kill where Quas and Phoenix just like 2-on-1 Inox in the mid lane. Otherwise, Dominate's a final scoreline, 15 of the 22 kills. That's pretty impressive. Highest on his team. Like overall, like just a solid game from Team Liquid. You got to see them play, unfortunately for enemy, largely unopposed.
Yeah.
They forced a lot of ganks. They all worked. They rotated well. They waited for two Barons to win the game, which you can't really complain about.
Piglet, the only man on his team to go deathless.
Good for Piglet. And he even tried to save a special
tryhard
with the ulti. What a tryhard. Either way, for more on Team Liquid's third straight win, let's send it down to Riv on the stage.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. Great cast on the day. Rivington here, joined by I Will Dominate, a Team Liquid, who just took down enemy esports quite handedly, if I'm going to say so myself. You said yourself, you're a little sad, your KDA just got hit. But coming into that game, Dominant, you guys got some amazing power picks. How did it feel just coming out of Champion Select?
It felt all right. I think we had a really good ban. When they banned LeBlanc and we banned Kog'Maw, I think that was a really good adaptation we made because it felt like they kind of wanted a Kog'Maw comp, and Varus isn't as strong of a Poke champion as Kog'Maw. So I think we kind of threw them for a loop there. And then we just ended up getting comfort picks for us all around the board.
So 3-0 now for you guys. Last split, it happened in the 2-0, and you said, keep it reserved. You know, there's still a long split to go. Are you guys kind of keeping that mentality still, or is it kind of full steam ahead?
We still have the same mentality. I mean, we haven't beat a top team yet. We've been playing like kind of like the middle to lower standing teams, or at least the predicted middle to lower standing teams. So I think that it's just kind of it's good to win these games. I mean, we kind of have a history of losing to the lower seeded teams and doing well against the top teams. But at least if we're getting our wins over the lower seeded teams, then hopefully when we go into the games versus the top teams, we're able to get some wins and we can actually get a good playoff standing for once.
All right, man, and talk to me a few more questions about the dynamic. It's definitely changed. You guys look so much more solid. Piglet's on his game again. What's the dynamic been like, and what was that change?
I just think we're a lot more comfortable. I mean, we kind of just have a more friendly team environment. I mean, Phoenix and Piglet both speak a lot more English now, so we can joke around the same way that, like, the old team used to. So I think it's just, like, we're all more comfortable around each other. We have, like, our own inside jokes and everything. So having that, like, joking and, like, happy side kind of helps if we go through like bad days of scrims. We bounce back a lot quicker, like as a unit.
Awesome. And final question: you guys have Gravity tomorrow, Move and Alltech now on that team. How are you feeling about that matchup?
We don't really know that much about that team. Move is kind of a new player to LCS, so I don't really know what to expect out of him. I think our team play should be better. That's how we've been able to pull out these victories. But they're all really skilled individual players, so they could always get ahead early game. So we got to watch out for that.
All right, Dom, congrats on the win. Best of luck in the rest of the season. Right now, we're going to throw it to the analyst desk to break down that game some more.
Thank you, Riv. And I do want to touch on the team comps. They were touched on a little bit there. As Dominate mentioned, banning out the Kog'Maw after seeing the LeBlanc ban, a good pivot from them. But really what I want to look at is the fact that they came out with so many huge picks.
Yes. So I want to just explain a little bit deeper the concept of power picks right now. The reason you can call them power picks is they're generally safe to pick in the majority of situations, and they're highly contested. And the reason this champ select was so poor for NME is, based on the bans, there were two power pick junglers up, Gragas and Rek'Sai, so there's no need to blow your first pick on the Gragas. The other power picks that are on the board, like the Ryze and the Kalista, don't have any things that match them. Ryze was 100% pick ban in Europe last week, and Kalista was 90% pick ban in North America last week. So we know those are the two, but they don't have anything that matches that. So by picking Gragas, they're allowing the Rek'Sai to fall down super far, giving two free power picks to Team Liquid, and basically making it so they're easily outnumbered, like 3-1 on the powerful picks. Like, that's terrible champ select trading. Whether or not you want to build a poke comp or build a versatile comp or whatever you're doing, trading power picks to that level almost never works well.
Yeah, there's a lot there. Like, you talked about the first pick, Gragas, was really just mind-boggling to me, because Trashy's most targeted band and most picked champion in Challenger was the Rek'Sai. So picking the Gragas over it was just, in and of itself, really strange to me, because they could have picked the Ryze. They could have let Team Liquid have whatever they wanted between the Gragas and the Rek'Sai. The only situation would be Quas being like, oh, I want to play top lane Rek'Sai, right? That's the only time they'd ever take both, which I don't think was going to happen. And the Thresh.
Yeah, it's like, not even talking about Thresh, because the other thing that you can that has been traded as far as picks is Alistar and Thresh, is the two top-tier supports.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Alistar was banned, therefore Thresh is now a higher-value pick, and they let Team Liquid get it in the second rotation as the fourth pick of their draft.
Right, yeah, so it seems what happened then is that they got stuck in this idea of a team comp that they wanted to play, a style they wanted to play, which was a bit of this poke disengage, and that's why they jumped at the Gragas, because that's the jungler that'll better allow them to
Absolutely.
Do that.
Yeah.
But what you're saying is that they needed to recognize, based on the bans, the direction that this champion select was going, and make the proper adjustments to disallow such high-priority picks to fall into the hands
Absolutely.
Of Team Liquid.
Absolutely. It's a lack of a pivoting in champion select there, which is a fault of the coaches, but also they didn't just change their vision after they saw the bans come out. And they're like, well, did they actually expect Ryze to make it through? And then they didn't pick it? Like, that's just kind of a lose-lose scenario there.
All right,
and
so
then the turret dive.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, let's get to the actual game.
So all of that happens before we even get into the game. Now we jump into the game, and we have a very unfortunate dive there from enemy early on in the lane swap. They're attempting an aggressive move to wrestle control into the game here. And I think part of it is the overcommit, as to why Team Liquid comes away with three kills.
I think he would have made contact without flashing there as well on Trashy's side. His body slam looked like that last part of the hitbox was actually still going to make it. Also, it's like, you don't have Otter and Body Drop in position just yet to assist on the damage towards Quas. If they had just waited a couple seconds, you would have just waited it off. He can just sit under tower. Then you dive him. You're going to be in a much better situation.
It looked a little bit to me like just jitters.
It was panic.
Yeah, because I think conceptually, that was a good play for them. Ryze is very dive under the turret. And technically, NME had the people there before Team Liquid had rotated their support down. Mm-hmm. So if they just kind of move into the lane and just
cut them off.
Well, that's the thing. Just sit there, because at that way, you're going to create separation between the support and jungler as well as Quas, and create a kill on either side. But by kind of having flashing it on one side, they spread themselves out, and then they're fighting the turrets as well as the three members, because they were outnumbering them regardless. It's one of those plays that I don't think they'd ever make in scrims, like that type of mistake, but it just seems like that's one of those new things to the stage.
And if you did, you GG right there, and then you
Well, so there's a couple things that I want, or a couple directions I want to go out of this. One is, you know, Team Liquid recognizing that they were in this tower dive scenario, and they did rotate their two members down. So it is nice to see the development of strategy to counteract these early turret dives.
They had all the information they needed. They had that ward there for so long. They saw the setup for it. They saw flares sitting in that bush. They saw Trashy wrap around, and they were like, all right, let's bait them into this. And then Quas throws a Q into the bush, and Trashy and Flares are like, we're still going to go with this play. So it seemed like NME was being stubborn in champion select and in game here, just kind of being like, we're not going to let them dictate the pace of the game. We're going to lose on our own terms.
And then, Jet, the other thing I want to look at is for NME, these teams that are going for early aggressive plays, when they don't work out, we're seeing how detrimental that can be to the rest of the game. Down 3K gold within a few minutes into the game. Would it behoove the newer, younger teams to play a more passive early game, at least give themselves the opportunity to move into a team fighting stage?
I'm not necessarily sold on that. Like, basically, they were... Like I said, I conceptually liked the turret dive play because Team Liquid wanted to swap away and almost have Ryze in the 1v2 and then just play that dive game and play it better. But Ryze is a very diveable champion when you're sending four people over there. I think it's one of those things that it'll take time for them to not choke in those situations, because it did feel like they just misplayed that, and it's not a play that I think they're going to misplay often. So continue with what you're doing if you're enemy. Change champion select, but in-game, it was just some big misplays.
Yeah, you're not going to get better at tower diving and being nervous at the same time if you don't at least try it.
Very good point. Well, 3-0 for Liquid now. We've got to take a quick recall for a break, but when we return, it's back into the action with Cloud9 versus Gravity. Keep it tuned right here. The North American LCS will be right back after this.